We got to talk about this on the show.
Yeah, all right, roll
this
it.
This is good. Yeah, hit the music. It. Yeah.
Of thunder coming to you live. Nick just cruised in, and he's got a smell of barbecued meat on him.
And the sentence that was just uttered before Andy hit the music, what was it? It was my dreams of a heat taking on a heat challenge are over at this point.
That's from Chris.
That was from Chris. We were talking about. I went to just a few minutes ago before coming to the studio.
Funny thing happened to me today.
Funny thing happened. I went to one of the finer barbecue places in the area and was just talking about it. And they had an atomic sauce. And I always back off of the hottest sauce. I'll go for the spicy, a little bit of heat. But, you know, they had, the Blazin' at BW3. I always heard that that was a nightmare if you had some of that. I don't know.
I've tried that before. I wouldn't describe it as a nightmare, but... Anyway, I was starting to say that I've had to back off of my always going for the hottest sauce just because in my advancing age it's starting to have ramifications, discomfort, and all that.
Catching up to you.
It's ultimately not worth it. I don't rebound like I used to.
What's now? Did you do like ghost chili and all that crazy stuff before? How crazy do you get?
No, I've never done it, but I seem to have a higher tolerance for it than most people, which is why I said I had dreams of attempting a heat challenge, food eating type thing. Right. I would never do a quantity challenge. Just
you could never handle one of those.
I don't think I would come out of that unscathed in terms of like long-term damage.
Right.
But they have some sort of like a Quaker steak over here. They have some sort of like ghost chili wings challenge that I had briefly considered doing, but I think that window's closed.
It's probably for the best.
Yeah.
It is for the best. I mean, I shouldn't be. It's like when I ate that pickle and drank the juice out of the bag. That was a bad idea.
That's just one of those things that.
That literally, the sodium spike sent me down to my knees.
So weird. I don't know what it is about that story, but it'll make me laugh every time.
You know what I was thinking.
You were just trying to beat your chest in front of us.
Yeah.
Show what a man you
were.
Was
that the first time you had drank the juice out of that?
Yeah.
I didn't really know what was coming?
I don't believe I've ever even eaten a packaged pickle before. But it just looked good. And then, you know, Andy and Vernon are standing there. I'm like, fuck it. I'm going to slam down this pickle juice. There's a fair amount of it in those pickle bags.
Yeah, that's probably like 4 ounces of pure salty liquid, right?
Wow, it's whatever the daily recommended sodium intake for a human being is, times it by like 500.
Then that's it.
I mean, if you look at the nutritional values on a pickle bag, you'd be shocked at what you find.
There's commas in the percentages.
Yeah, it's insane amount of sodium. I literally had to take a knee after doing that. I was in serious trouble for like 30 seconds.
Wow. I mean, and those pickles, those things could stay alive in that bag probably for a while, huh?
Yeah, that's one of those like apocalyptic foods. Yeah. I think you can...
Yeah, you know, one of those big deli pickles.
Yeah, if that gas station closed in about 10 years, they could probably sell off the rest of their stock to another.
You could walk in there 10 years later and grab one of those pickles right out of there.
Yeah, you could grab.
Still good.
You can grab a sister pickle to the one that took you down if you wanted to.
I wonder if the sodium.
Sister pickle. That's a good combination of words. This love sister pickle.
I wonder if the sodium content increases over time. So that was fucking near lethal.
Or would it absorb into the pickle slowly?
It's not a bad idea. So, yeah, I'm done doing crazy food shit.
Yeah. I hear ya. And then another thing Nick was talking about before we started was while he was hanging out at this barbecue place, I don't know if it was before or after. Nick's laughing at something.
Okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Are you laughing at a text?
Yeah, you sent me a picture.
I don't know Some of those like Jones brother.
Yeah, exactly. Moments. I'm sitting over here like, what the hell are these dickheads doing?
Well,
over
Andy
here?
sending me these private messages during the broadcast here. Is this the story you're talking about right now or
no? No.
Okay, because this picture is pretty funny. But anyway, yeah. Go ahead.
But Nick was,
get on with it.
Nick was also saying either before or after, I don't know, the barbecue place, he was checking out the new Danzig cover album.
I was.
I didn't know there was one. So, Nick, enlighten us for others who don't know.
I went to this barbecue place with a good buddy of mine who is a much bigger fan of... I enjoy the Misfits and some Danzig, whatever, but not like this guy. This guy is very much into it. But somehow, this new covers album slipped under his radar. He saw the album cover, flipped out about how horrible / great it is and how he has to buy it just for the cover.
Wow.
Which I'm sure probably a good amount of the listeners are, have at least seen it or checked it out, but it really sounds, if he's going for like raw underproduced, then that's what he accomplished. And he picked some oddball stuff, which is cool. If you're doing a covers album, it's kind of nice to not have,
Mother.
Well, or say, what, like Andy was complaining when you guys went to the Alice Cooper thing, how it was like My Generation. The big hits from all these acts.
Right.
Which Danzig didn't do necessarily, but I don't know. It's I don't know. He's, to me, sounding almost like some of the parody videos that you see.
Was it Skeletons?
Yeah, Skeletons is what it was. Mm.
Danzig himself put this together?
Yeah, like late 2015, I think. It's pretty.
But he recorded it?
Yeah,
re-recorded some. Of
yeah, it's
stuff?
A cover.
No, it's
yeah,
not his stuff.
It's a covers album of like he does like an Elvis song, and he does it like an Aerosmith song.
Oh, I hear you. Okay,
he's the producer.
A ZZ Top song.
ZZ Top song.
Here's what we got. I don't even know who that is. Dave Allen and the Aeros.
Yeah, there's a few of them. I was like, I don't know.
Paul Weibier. I don't know what that shit is. Let go.
Alan Schwartzman.
Let Yourself Go by Elvis. NIB by Black Sabbath. Lord of the Thighs by Aerosmith.
Yeah, okay.
I've never heard of that.
It's an oldie.
The Litter. I don't know The Litter. Rough Boy by ZZ Top.
Oh, my God. That's interesting.
Yeah. Crying in the Rain by the Everly Brothers.
That White Snake.
No, I'm afraid not. That's it, right?
Maybe that was a couple others.
Maybe White Snake did an Everly Brothers cover. I doubt it, though. So it's lo-fi shit production?
It's about as raw as you're going to get this day and age, yeah. Very dry sounding, like the vocals particularly. It sounds like there was nothing done to the vocal. They just gave him a mic and he did it in one take and no editing, no anything.
Really?
I mean, it's cool in that regard, but I don't know.
So similar production values to this podcast.
probably about as good.
Equal amount of editing.
Shitty, lazy, all of the above.
What's the standout of the songs you heard?
Oh, boy. I guess it would depend on for what reason. I don't know. The ZZ Top one was probably the better one that we checked out.
That's nice for Daddy. Yeah.
I guess. You were setting me up.
That's intriguing, because I mean, that's like a ballad almost.
Yeah, that was probably the better one that I heard.
Now it's his regular band with him?
I think
what
so.
What have you?
I believe.
Currently in Danzig?
Yeah.
Is John Christ still the guitarist?
There's no John Christ.
I don't know, but there's a lot of pinch harmonics.
There's Tommy Victor.
I've heard of that name, but yeah, pinch harmonics, not good.
No, you know, it's...
Tired of it.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. Fun to do...
Zach Wilde kind of ruined it forever.
I was reading somewhere. Well,
laying it way too thick.
Speaking of, because we were talking about Sabbath last week, now, does he tour as Zach Sabbath sometimes?
I don't know.
Or is that just kind of like a moniker people attach to it? Like
it's unbelievable.
He does.
I've actually never heard of that.
He does Sabbath, like kind of like all Sabbath stuff, and I've read reviews where they say the pinch harmonics are just... so excessive even for him. It just ruins the riffs. And
grab any Black Label Society album that's just pinch harmonic every 5 or 6 seconds.
No,
it's like he can't not do it.
Yeah, yeah. It's like exhaling.
Yeah.
Now, Speaking of pinch harmonics, that seems to be a theme here all of a sudden. Any Kiss songs? I'm trying to think of some genuine pinch harmonics. Not really. I think we had Ace does some kind of stuff where he'll do like a very muted kind of thing with the pick like that, but I don't know.
I can't think of
any examples where they utilized it.
I'm surprised that wasn't all over Revenge based on the timing, but
Bruce didn't. He dabbled in that stupid overhand technique, like in the Tears Are Falling video, which may have just been for show.
Shut the fuck up.
It took me a while to forgive him for that nonsense.
Classic moments.
But this is what Chris said when he saw that.
Shut up, you goddamn stupid asshole!
I did think he was kind of a goddamn stupid asshole for a while for doing that. That was an eye roll moment for me. It's like, just stop with that. Leave that shit to Michelangelo Batio or whatever that fucking wig wearing Jagoff's name is.
And a pirate shirt. Or is he not one of those guys?
Yeah, he wears like a fucking muscle jacket, or whatever. Okay. Like bad wig. Like necks of guitars pointing everywhere. It's just stop. Play a song, you dickhead. Speaking of songs, how's the generator looking today?
It's looking good. It's heated up to a balmy low 40s in the area.
So, warmed up a bit, yeah.
Yeah, a little bit.
You like that?
I do. Open up the pool next week. Let's
you should
do
have
it.
Brought some of that atomic hot sauce to dump into it, see what happens.
I don't know.
Now, what, do you have merchandise
to prime
the pump, as it were?
As always, indeed.
Andy gave me an if you will earlier when I was walking in. He's wearing his work outfit here.
I know.
Skinny tie and girls' pants.
We're talking about girls' pants. Those are gentlemen's slacks.
And are those the purple slippers?
They are.
And I'm like, did you just get home, or why didn't you change out your work clothes?
Like, these are my pajamas.
I just didn't have time to unwind, if you will.
What is that?
I believe I will. Sure, why not? Thanks for asking.
What, an hour after you get home? I'm not done unwinding.
Nope.
Dude, my pants are off by the time I hit the living room.
It's like this is a Knicks wheelhouse, like old-time TV shows where the guy's relaxing around the house in a fucking tie.
Like,
how is it comfortable?
Like Fred McMurray.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's how I do it. Ward Cleaver on a Saturday afternoon wearing a shirt and tie.
It does seem pretty strange to do that.
Now, when you guys see that, do you ever kind of feel somewhat like, you know what, I should be taking a page out of this?
Yeah.
Because
no?
I'm very underdressed most of the time in my life. And I'm watching shows and movies from that time period. I'm like, would that do something for me?
It might.
You know, if I wore a... long sleeve and a tie and the slacks all day
long. Around the house, you can wear whatever you want, but when you venture out in like basketball shorts and you're not going to the gym or whatever.
You're not playing basketball?
Yeah. You're just a fucking slob at that point. You know? Anything with an elastic waist should not leave your property ever.
Unless it's at a gym.
Yeah, but nobody's doing that. I actually had this conversation with your wife on Facebook.
Yeah.
About all the slobs around here. It's like, yeah, you're not going to the gym. You're just a fucking slob. Get dressed. Fuck.
Get dressed.
But no, I mean, shirt and tie around the house, that's a little extreme. Find a happy medium.
Yeah, look at Andy.
Is it doing something for me?
You're glowing. You're positively glowing.
Yep, see?
Yeah, we're over here slumming it in our Pot of Thunder gear.
Both wearing Pot of Thunder items.
How about that?
Is that a sweatshirt neck?
Yes.
I couldn't tell if it was long.
The crew neck, I think it is.
Oh, is it? Looks good.
It's good.
I couldn't tell if it was the long sleeve tee.
You got
or the
Paul
crew neck.
Paul I,
yes.
Two designs, tpublic.com.
Yeah. More to come,
more
possibly.
More to come, we're hoping.
More on that later.
More on that later. Nice teaser.
Yeah, we got to scratch together some money somehow.
Yeah, those sales really dried up. It was nice for the first month, And I don't think I've seen one. In a while. Maybe one in the last month.
We'll wait till Pot of Thunder month.
Next. Which, it's not the same month every year.
No, well,
I'll have you know.
Yeah, and there's... Yeah.
Anybody can do that.
It happens several times during the year.
It was November
It's a round robin kind of a setup.
Yeah, exactly. It could be twice this year.
Yeah.
It will be.
All right. So, Nick, how...
What's the merchandise you got there?
Yeah. Well... What are we doing?
Let me kind of take a moment here and enjoy my jawbreaker.
I wanted clicking noises over here.
That was a moment where we did Chris, these cameras.
Chris put his mic down, and I said that, he's like, "All right, I'm picking it back up."
Yeah, he put his mic down.
Usually, when I give my spiel, he puts the mic down.
Yeah, and does his personal things. But he had to pick it back up.
Yeah, because
His bookie.
I don't want to interrupt his nonsense that he's been working on all week.
So,
you know. The one bit of pre-production that goes into this program.
Right. So, it's a toy for the youngins, for the children. And I don't know if, you guys may never have heard of it, but it's a pretty cool toy. The original one, it's a symphony toy. And what it is you've got like a little bandstand, a little plastic bandstand.
Right.
And you press play, it'll play the songs, and you can actually, it comes with little plastic instruments. And there's some kind of sensor on the bottom where when you put them into the middle of the bandstand, it'll continue playing the song, and it'll only play what those instruments are playing.
Right.
So kind of like, you know, playing with like a 12-track recorder, you know, like whatever, sort of, like for kids to kind of think, oh, okay, the different instruments do the different stuff.
What have you.
I have a prototype by the same company.
Prototype.
And it's got the little Kiss figurines.
Love that.
The little each member,
mm-hmm.
And when you play the songs, it does the same thing. So you can listen to, say, you want to listen to Strutter, and you just want to hear what Gene and Peter are laying down.
Okay,
and you can do that. Just put those pieces in the middle. Yeah,
that's kind of cool.
That is cool.
Yeah.
So and then you know it's got the other guys as well.
Kind of like those isolated tracks you see on YouTube.
Those are hot right now.
Yeah,
I've been hot for a while. It was the Guitar Hero game where you could separate out everything.
Yep. Gave the masses a chance to do their own mixes of some of their favorite songs. So, yeah, I've got this really super awesome toy here. So, I'm gonna go fire it up. I'm going to put all six. Well, it's actually got eight because it's got two different spacemen and two different catmen. So I'm putting all eight characters in there.
Okay.
Hooking up the USB interface.
And that's how we're gonna do it, via USB.
Yeah, and I'm just gonna, you know, the song generator kind of has moods,
right?
So it's gonna let us know how it's feeling based on what we present, as always.
Sure.
So yeah, that's what it is.
And for those of you who are new to the show, there might be some confusion, but we have this machine here that is the Kiss Random Song Generator. That every week somehow Nick has a piece of merchandise that interacts with the machine.
And it's always a super rare piece of merchandise.
Right.
Good luck finding these on the market.
Yeah, so rare that many people maintain that they don't even exist at all.
They're just not serious collectors.
Right.
That's their own problem.
They're just being assholes with that stance.
They're just walking around the street with their basketball shorts on.
Jealousy, envy over it. What's this, the family... What's this gas station over here? It used to be Thornton's.
Family Circle.
Family Express.
Express.
Yeah. Keep getting a jug of milk and whatever else they need.
Yeah.
Fucking slobs. Anyway.
Nick's piece of merchandise interacts with the machine, and then that tells us what song we will be discussing today. But if you're the listener, you already know, because it's the title of the episode. At this point, as we're recording, we do not know. So... It will be drawn at random after Nick connects his rare piece of merchandise to the random song generator via USB today.
Yes.
Is that 2.0 or 3.0?
It's like a 1.7.
Oh, okay.
But it's still, that was the best year for it.
Oh, it was.
Yeah.
So that's perfect.
Yeah. So
is it a bottle of wine or a fucking USB port.
It's a vintage.
Okay.
The materials and the chemical processes, some of them aren't even legal anymore that they used in the older models.
Got lead in it or something?
Yeah, well, there's like certain things, and they say that about old microphones. So that's why the old microphones from years ago go for
ribbon mics.
Yeah.
What do they have? Is it lead or do they have some other mercury or something?
I don't know exactly. I can't pinpoint
something
exactly.
That gives you cancer when you inhale
but
when you're talking.
All the big
Flint
time.
Water supply.
Yeah.
Right.
All the big time studios, they want to get these, I can't think of what the model number was, but these old vocal mics, you know, the ones that everybody swears by.
Sure. Dave Grohl is hoarding them as we speak.
He's probably making a documentary about them as we speak.
And talk about how fucking great they are, man.
And then
Then
everyone posts about it.
Yeah, exactly, with his fucking simpering, toothy face.
Tired of him.
Sick of it. Actually, his boy Josh Holm or whatever from Queens of the Stone Age, he's fucking becoming omnipresent. He's hooked up with Iggy Pop.
Boy.
Wonderful. Is that the guy that looks like Craig Kilborn?
Right, yeah. Exactly.
I remember when that Queens of the Stone Age, you know, the No One Knows song came out.
Yeah.
I'm like, wow, Dave Grohl and Craig Kilborn.
Yeah, right?
All right.
Good combo.
I wonder who's going to replace Kilborn and then take it, you know, to greater success like every other thing Kilborn does.
Damn, you're right.
Dang.
Two for two.
Okay. So I'm going to go fire this up now that I'm fired up.
Yeah.
Here
let's
I go,
get,
walking
let's get
away
down to
over
business.
Here.
Love that thing. Love that song. Love that machine.
Yeah,
and
the
Andy,
song really.
Andy fired a shot.
I did
at the late during the. And Chris has got that gun.
Chris has the pistol.
He might fire back if we hear that again.
No, I never know. I like.
Well, how about one more?
Music. I never said I did.
Might be pretending like it's a Star Wars thing.
No, I like it. It's added to the show. Makes the song generator tolerable.
But I think Nick's just saying that you like it so much that you're miming along with the song.
That's what Andy did, yeah.
Yeah, like a little laser
Andy
thing.
Andy fired a shot.
Yeah. That's not directed at the song being bad. It's like this rule. So I'm going to pretend. It's like air drumming.
Yeah.
Air lasering.
That. Yeah.
Which what
play
have
it
you.
Again.
All right, here we go.
You know, and every time we hear that, I think of the clip that I saw on YouTube.
Yeah.
With the, you know, the original Sports Machine music and just, you know, almost like Wide World of Sports with people falling
right.
over.
Right.
Skiing accidents.
That's the best.
And whatnot.
Spanning the globe. All right. Let's get something out of this thing.
Let's do it.
What are we, a half hour into this fucking episode?
Sometimes that's the way it goes. We'll buzz through the song. Unless it's, you know, a good one.
Unless it's charisma. Then
yeah.
We got two
then
parts.
We're in big trouble.
Then we'll have to end it and then gather our thoughts for a week. Well, all right. I've got it.
You got it?
I am here with it. Here.
This one comes off.
Monster.
It's called.
All for the Love of Rock and Roll.
All right.
Jesus. Another. That was. Our guy who does the statistics for this show, did you see he posted that sort of list of the numbers of tracks from each album? Do you realize we've done 10 Hot in the Shade cuts
really?
Already?
Jeez.
Yeah, those numbers were surprising.
That's pretty high.
Monster, though, I've always been aware of the fact that we've done a ton of songs off of it, and here's another one. So
add some more.
I wonder which album we're going to finish first.
Oh, we've technically finished Smashes, Thrashes.
Oh, well, yeah, I guess so. But, yeah, as far as a full one, I mean, Hot in the Shade, there's so many songs. I don't know. This one has got to be close.
Yeah, this and Gene's solo album.
Yeah.
This can't be completed soon enough for me. You know, again, we'll just say it again. Monster, just... We don't dislike it, but it's just nothing exciting.
Well, some of us. Nick likes it.
I do like it.
That's right.
Nick just flat out likes it.
I do.
That's interesting. I don't know. I can't get excited about anything on Monster.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I don't really dislike anything. This song, I can honestly say I probably never heard. I just, it just doesn't come up on shuffle, and when it does, I see the title and I click pass.
It just
doesn't interest me.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's weird.
Right. Yeah. This one right now, I know I've heard everything on this, heard the whole album. Hearing this title, I can't remember which one this is. I should remember, but I can't.
So, 2012, right?
The last Kiss album until now.
Up until maybe later in 2016, allegedly.
Is that
what's... I don't know when exactly, but it just with what they're hinting toward.
Mm.
I wouldn't doubt it later this year. I mean, it's not official, but could certainly happen. This podcast can go on for up to 3 months.
Three longer. Additional months?
Depending on the number of tracks, if it's about 12, which I would assume is around that number.
Man.
Yeah, let's hope that doesn't happen.
Unless it's a double disc.
Oh, God. Maybe they'll come out with a covers album with Danzig.
I don't know. I think it's time for someone to tell Danzig that he could put a shirt on.
Oh, boy. I'm not going to tell him.
He don't got it no more. Sorry.
Kind of like Anthony Kiedis, you know.
Is he getting there?
He's losing it a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, there comes a
time.
Which
is far for me to talk, but.
But, I mean, you're not walking around shirtless putting photos on album covers.
That hasn't been my shtick over the years.
Right.
And the world should be grateful for that.
Yeah. The man's developing breasts. I think it's time to put a shirt on. I mean, it happens to everyone. But, you know.
Well,
maybe you stop putting it on album covers. That's
At least put the fishnet shirt back.
There you go. That's a compromise.
There's nothing wrong with that.
We can get
behind
that.
Actually, there's a lot wrong with that.
Right.
It's better than
less wrong.
Just having no shirt on.
Right.
Stop. Just cease it.
Well,
what are you looking up over there?
12 songs on the album Monster. This is track 10. The Lone Rider, Paul Stanley.
How about it? I'd say let's just get into it.
Yeah, let's get rolling on this one.
Yeah, yeah. So right off the bat, we got a bit going on here. I'm hearing Mr. Speed, by the way.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a classic sounding Kiss riff right there.
Very similar to Mr. Speed, if
you don't
recall correctly.
A lot of on this album. There was more of them on Monster to my ears.
Yeah.
Now, is that Paul on vocals? Or
this is
like
not
singer,
Paul.
Right?
It is singer. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
Paul wrote it, and he gave it over to singer.
Yep.
Just like he did on Sonic Boom. I believe he was the lone writer on...
that college football song that...
Yeah.
All for the Glory.
All for the Glory, yeah.
I think he was. Well, he was definitely the main guy on it, but... Yeah,
Poncia have a role in that.
I don't think he's been around.
No
much.
Outside writers on the last two albums.
Yeah,
interesting.
Not allowed.
So what's the title of this song?
All for the Love of Rock and Roll. Right after Hooked on Rock and Roll last week by the other Catman.
Right.
I'm sensing a theme.
I think that theme ends after two, probably. But yes.
Maybe Eric Singer was vaccinated with a Victrola needle as well.
Let's find out.
He was almost vaccinated with Andy's fist at last year's Indie Expo.
Yeah, I got my beer breath on him.
Yeah, he was drunk. Drunk and belligerent, at Eric Singer.
You killed whatever bacteria was on his neck, that's for sure, with that breath.
Hilarious. The tension in that room. Palpable.
I think I drank enough to feel it twice in 2015. That was one time.
That was definitely one time.
Yeah.
Anybody there can vouch for that.
Yeah. But I mean, that's kind of expected. I think anytime I'm going to go to one of these things,
well,
I'm
going to
pound a few beers.
Especially when your nemesis is there.
Right, yeah.
Have you ever looked at the comments on the video from last year's Indie Expo?
No.
We're listening to it, maybe just kind of bring it up. One of them is commenting on Andy and his state.
Oh, fuck.
And
read the comments.
There's not very many, but the one...
I'm afraid to read
The one makes me laugh. It comments on Andy's whatever.
My demeanor, maybe?
Andy's the balance of certain chemicals in his bloodstream.
I mean, I wasn't that. I had like three beers. I just...
Well, someone's questioning that.
All right.
All right. Roll some song.
I mean, I really turned it on, but yeah, here we go. Hold on. What is this?
Stop the video. The fucking autoplay.
Damn autoplay. What have you. All right.
All right. Similar theme to Peter's solo tune from the previous episode.
And I'm detecting...
I wonder if he's going to be yelling at any old women on this one. If he dust off Andy's favorite sound bite.
Whether or not that happens, I challenge Andy to just find the best part to throw that in.
Did you ever capture the audio, or you got to go back to E-bombs?
I got to go back to that to find it.
So I'm musically another thing that's jumping out. That's a Paul Stanley thing. I'm getting the verse kind of melodically and rhythmically the verse from his solo album from It's All Right.
Okay. I'm
just throwing that out there.
Right. I'll keep my ears open for
that. We got Mr. Speed and It's All Right. So we got a lot of Paul throwback
riffing
stuff going on here,
which is never a bad thing.
Right.
So what is it like a drummer thing that they have to sing about their rock and roll history?
Well, they have nothing else to offer.
That's true.
Drummers are very one-dimensional people.
They never get laid, so they can't really sing about that aspect of life.
I think we've talked about this before, but drummers, baseball catchers, and goalies are all kind of the same people. Hmm. Kind of the weirdo in the back who you don't really want to acknowledge. No offense, Nick was a catcher in Little League, but you know what I mean. It's like
they like having equipment,
right?
You know, they like to have
gearheads,
more equipment, more visible equipment than anybody else
right
on the squad.
There's something.
You know? It's like what are they compensating for with that approach?
Right.
Yeah, you're right. Just weird fucking people.
Yeah.
Hold on, was that Gene singing that second line there?
No, I think he just kind of had a little bit more gravel in his voice.
It. Yeah. It's like, are they switching off on vocals?
Be a nice combo. You know, I got to tell you, I'm a little tired of this theme in general of like, here's my story. I went for my dreams. I mean, it's like the age-old story and, you know, you hope people do that and succeed, but I just don't want to hear about it anymore.
And rock and roll is the ultimate.
Yeah, I really hope he doesn't mention blues again.
You never know.
Set off on that.
Right. Just tired. I'm tired of hearing the same story.
Well, and like Gene's, you know, I'm going to live my life the way I want. Get out of my way.
Yeah, exactly.
I'll roll over you if you put up any sort of resistance to my way of life, that sort of thing.
And you know, on one hand I say this and you agree with me, but then on the other hand, when something from Music from the Elder comes up, we're like, what the hell is this shit, where they're actually you know, they wrote like a story and it's
well,
a
that's one extreme
album
to the other.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, guess a happy medium is,
I mean, we're getting like, let's face it, it's like the cliche is what we're getting right now,
right?
And the Elder is just the other side of the spectrum.
Yeah. Well, I have the lyrics up if you have any questions, if we need to review.
Yeah, I don't really have any yet. I don't care enough to have any questions, to be honest.
It doesn't even need to be in English. I don't care at this point. Whatever. And that YouTube comment that Nick brought up, I will read from a man named Hank Lockwood. Jesus, Andy, how many beers did you have? 40?
Jesus. Visibly intoxicated.
You know,
I wasn't that bad.
I should say I'm a lightweight then, because if I was bad, I didn't drink a lot.
40.
If I acted like I drink 40, well then
I love it.
What have you?
40.
Yeah,
that's a lot.
40 beers.
That would
no.
nothing.
No, that's like Andre the Giant.
I was just gonna say something about Andre the Giant. Yeah. there's a lot of head shaking, and it's not to the rhythm here.
It's not up and down head shaking. It's side to side.
It's not
head
to
shaking.
The not to the beat necessarily, or yeah. to the tambourine that has entered the picture.
Much to Andy's dismay.
Put it this way: if Gene was the one commissioned to sing, I didn't do it for the money. He'd choke on that lyric.
He couldn't even sing.
Yeah, no, he'd do the Fonzie thing where he couldn't say "I'm sorry," you know.
Right.
I mean, just if it's a place to play, I'm gonna go. Yeah. Well, Gene right. ain't following unless yeah. there's some payment up front. So yeah, that's what I think. That's what I was shaking my head about. But yeah, you know. I guess that the upside is that lyric sort of made me hearken back to the Coventry days when the original drummer was doing the between song banter we love
right.
so much.
Yeah.
Those were the days. Music in the air, and I'm losing control. I don't care what you heard. I don't care what you told. Cause it's all for the love of rock. What did he say? $50 in a what?
It says in a fight. What does that mean?
What's the line again?
What's the line before it?
And I read, I hitched a ride on a trip going nowhere, got $50 in a fight.
Oh, he got $50 and he also got a fight. That's what he got out of the trip.
Maybe that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
Not saying, yeah.
I have a feeling it's going to rhyme with something, though.
Be more believable if it came from Peter.
That's
true.
He's
always mixing it up with somebody, getting in dust ups
and
whatnot.
He got $50 in the fight.
Right.
Yeah,
exactly.
Because he searched the guy's pockets.
He bet a guy $50 he could beat him up.
Yeah, he fucking rolled him after he knocked his ass out. That's how Peter rolls. Old school Bronx action.
Just a blackjack and search his pockets.
Fucking knock you out, go through your pockets, and then piss on your face as he walks away. The deluxe treatment.
the table shower treatment.
There you go.
No,
you
that's
no, I know.
Okay, what's that line? That sounds interesting.
This whole verse, or whatever you want to call this, is actually the most interesting part of the song so far.
I sensed that too.
When you're finished with the band and some honey grabs your hand, yeah, you get to thinking you might.
I like that. That's really the reason why we all got into music, isn't it?
You know,
this type of music.
No.
Not really.
No. Really?
We're weird.
I don't think so.
What did you guys get into it for? Self-expression?
Yeah. Probably.
It's honest. This is an honest question.
No, it is. And I hate to sound like square, I guess, in the face of it.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, all the major guys out there, they'll say, oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, girls liked that.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're holding a guitar, girls liked it.
Right.
I don't know. Any musical endeavor I ever was part of, there were no girls.
Right.
But I don't know.
I was just trying to get some to leave me alone. Maybe if I embarrass
show them how,
myself,
show them how weird
away.
You are in front of them. Yeah.
No, but what was your motivation for performing in front of people publicly? Recording music.
I think it was just to like come up with something from nothing and then be proud of it and just listen back to it.
I can understand that, sure.
And then performing, it was just fun. Like I don't know.
I think initially, honestly, take it however you want, but it's more of like a male bonding experience, really, like with your friends.
Yeah.
That's what it was more for me.
It's like a bowling team.
The camaraderie.
Yeah, more that.
Okay, I can relate to that, too.
Yeah, it wasn't like,
Both of those are applicable to my experience as well, but where is the getting laid component for you guys? Non-existent?
It non-existent in, as far as musical performance or expression.
Yeah, there's something wrong with you too.
Well, you saw,
I can't relate.
You
to that
saw
at
the
all.
Bands that we were in. Yeah. Where was the get? There was no getting laid part.
Well, that's true, but you know,
that wasn't. It wasn't like, oh, what do girls like? Yeah, let's make sure we work that into it. It was like the complete opposite.
I'm not saying that you pander to women. I'm saying that what women appreciate about musicians is the talent and the sort of confidence you exude on stage.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, that did happen. That
of course,
you know,
it happened, but you weren't motivated.
Right.
Yeah, I can't relate to that at all. That's foreign concept to me. I don't know what's wrong with you.
I mean, did you have like an epiphany kind of thing where you had the first time like in public being seen with a guitar? There, you know, some little honey grabbed your hand like in the song,
or was it before that?
Or was like, or you know, you had caught the attention of a Motown Philly, if you will.
Well, that happened later on in college when I actually started playing publicly in rock bands. In high school, I was in the jazz band.
Okay.
And, you know, it was that I was like, it was a challenge, and it was, again, camaraderie and a common goal and do this and that. But, you know, all along I'd have preferred to have, you know, been doing something else where there was chicks lined up for you. I mean, that's the whole reason to play rock music.
I mean,
as far as I'm concerned, the main reason, you guys touched on it, camaraderie is a huge thing.
Yeah.
It's like you're a cohesive unit, you know, moving ahead toward a common goal. And then what was your motivation that you brought up?
I don't know. Oh, I just said, as far as recording,
creating
or writing,
something from nothing and being proud. Yeah.
Just that, in general, that's something that appeals to me.
I don't know. There's got to be something related to the libido there. At least, I don't know. I can't relate to someone who for that was a non-factor. That just doesn't resonate.
You know, I think it came later. After I was done being in bands, I think I would have more of that, I don't know. That didn't set in at the early age we were playing in bands. Like when I was like 15 or 16, it wasn't really a concern of mine. It was actually kind of the opposite because it was like, oh no, this girl wants to hang out with me. I don't have a car. I don't even have a license. How am I, my mom take me to her? You know, it was almost like a thing to avoid at that age.
Right.
But then, I don't know, when I got older, I could at least see using it to supplement or at least to help you out, you know, get a conversation started. But, you know, it was already past that time for me. So,
although my wife did say one time, and we were already involved, though, so it had nothing to do with the musical performance attracting her.
Yeah.
But she did say, she's like, yeah, there's like when like you particularly, but like, you know, like when guys play, when they perform, there's kind of like a thing where you wonder if that's the face that they're making in other situations But see, that wasn't like a thing where... Like, she kind of explained, I guess, the attraction to the performer, because you never really hear that. You just hear, like, it just seems like, oh, girls are mindless, and they just, oh, there's a guy on stage. But she kind of explained, like, some of part of what the attraction could be about.
There's that, and they're drawn to the talent.
Sure.
They're drawn to the confidence you exude up there. And they're also drawn to the danger of it, the whole, you know...
There's some truth to that too.
Of course, there's. Truth
I think that's
to
probably
it.
The most truth, which is sounding.
It's a combination of everything, but you know, I don't know. It shocks me that you guys didn't have that whatsoever as a motivation.
One little thing of note on Nick's, I could tell you that's not the face I make.
You made a lot of faces.
I used to make a lot of faces, but
what about the one where you lay there and spit in the air and let it fall on your face?
That's a good one.
I imagine that's what you're doing.
That's actually probably the most accurate to translate to the bedroom.
Doesn't surprise me at all.
Mine's more like when you see a video of a turtle making love. You ever see like a tortoise
like
humping a shoe,
like looking like it's in agony, with its mouth open,
dry tongue sticking out?
Like it's just screaming.
Yeah.
Maybe if you took your tie off, you'd loose it up a bit.
That might help.
That's a lot of tension you're trying to release all at once. All at once.
Jesus.
Oh. At once. That's when you know there's dead to win. Oh,
are we talking about banging married women like in Hotter Than Hell with the talking about rings on fingers and whatnot?
Yep. That's when you notice there's a ring on her finger. That's when she tells you that she's single tonight.
Damn.
Now there's danger on both sides now.
Yeah.
This is some scandalous shit we're talking about now.
I mean, this guy might get stabbed if, you know, there's an element of danger on both sides.
Yeah, this is a potential problem.
He's playing with fire. Gotta watch it, man.
Yeah.
Dicking around with married people. That's some serious shit. You gotta proceed with caution.
I mean, right. They weren't married, but look what happened to Johnny with Rosa and Tito.
Yeah.
He took a bullet, huh?
Yeah.
While he was banging Rosa, which
on
not
a bad way. On
a night. It's not a bad way to go out when you think
like
about
right
it.
Right next to the chimney.
Yeah, but still, he probably would have...
Something just fall?
Something
what was that?
Fell over there by your flying buttresses on the wall.
Yeah. What have you? Something fell off of that?
No, I don't know. I don't know what it was.
I just heard
Andy has this wonderful shelf with this incredible architectural feel with the flying buttresses.
It does, right?
Yeah.
It's nice.
Incredible.
Yeah, what have you?
Should really see this.
It's something. And it has a Bugs Bunny USB drive in it.
Wow. Yeah, you got to fill that thing up.
It's pretty bare at the moment. It's like a 2-inch tall.
What do I got? Bugs Bunny USB.
That's about it.
All right.
What, some Chase business cards up there? What is
that's
that?
That's my checkbook.
Oh, there you go.
What not. Some bills on
what
the right.
What have you.
What have yous. Trying to be one of those guys. Keeps
Where's
bills
your,
in one place. Pays them.
I forget it. Just move along.
Where's your forget it?
Just something I noticed. I'm sure you guys noticed it as well. This being a Paul Stanley penned joint.
Yeah.
Paul is probably the most, well, Eric Singer, I guess. He has the little lead parts, but he's probably the most present individual in the chorus, in the gang vocals.
Yeah.
I mean, you hear Paul above everybody.
Right.
So he's, you know, making his mark, even though
he
gave
made
the song
his mark
to him.
With the... Telltale rhythm riff. I mean, that's all Paul Stanley. But I don't know. I can't get too excited about this one. It's not doing it for me.
Right.
But we have a bridge here where they've changed gears a bit. So let's maybe talk some more about banging this married woman. That would be interesting.
Specific times.
Yep, that's another.
That's a Paul Stanley. Yep,
8:45. Is that what you said?
Why? Why 8:45? Well, I mean,
wasn't 8:45 exactly from All Night?
Damn it!
Wasn't the part of the lyrics actually has 8:45?
I can't.
So
remember.
two things in history happen at 8:45.
At least two.
At
things.
Least, but we know for sure these two. Interesting.
Is she clutching her breasts in the haze as well?
Right, you know, I'm throwing old lyrics back at you.
I'm getting a vibe here that this song is kind of a response and a defense, almost, because Kiss, above most bands, gets the most heat as far as, oh, these guys are money grubbing, you know, they'll do anything for a buck, they'll put anything out there. This sounds like a defense. where they're saying, look, it's really what it, when you get down to it, what it's about is being on stage and playing the type of music that we're playing.
You have to do what you love.
Yeah. And, you know, definitely not knocking that, but I'm just, after the bridge there, I was getting the feeling that, it's sort of an answer to that, that they get accused of quite often.
I'll go along with that.
Yeah, and, you know, fill up an album, you can toss off some lyrics about this.
I guess.
And whatever. They don't have any, they don't have to apologize to anybody or explain themselves at this juncture.
I agree with that.
So.
All right, ready for the solo?
Let's hear Mr. Thayer. Sorry I interrupted it.
No, I should have stopped it. We always stop before. You. I have my head in my behind. Chris is pointing a pistol at me. I'm nervous.
Got the gun out.
For the solo. It's the Pot of Thunder gun. I don't know. Russian roulette.
There you go.
What happened?
It all works.
One pull of the trigger. Yeah. That's all you're going to get.
Find that video.
Just play it.
Yeah, we're getting very R&B here with like the with him throwing those little accentual vocal things there.
He's adopting the Catman persona after all these years of wearing the makeup.
I think the song was influenced by R. Kelly's Body Kiss. what was that line?
Mr. Big and the Isley Brothers.
What was that line from last week that you talked about?
The go upstairs and get your shit and get the fuck up out of here.
Yeah, love that.
Yeah, it's good stuff. That's a great one.
Sounds straight out
Busted. Classic.
I mean, and then ultimately it sounds like he took all that and made the Trapped in the Closet 12-part epic or whatever it is.
I think we've talked about Trapped in the Closet.
I think we did, but I
when you watch the whole thing, it's like hilarious. And then I think,
but it wears you down too.
It wears you down
to where it's not funny anymore.
But I feel like when it was serious to him, it was hilarious to everyone else. And then when he found out it was funny, he tried to make it like, oh, then there's a midget.
Yeah.
And it just got dumb.
Yeah.
And then him dressed up in like Meet the Clumps outfits and stuff.
Yeah,
the first
four, I think, chapters.
It was funny when it was serious.
Yeah, that's what you need to stick with.
Yeah, he lost it. Lost the plot, so to speak.
So what do you think about the solo? Any?
It was okay. I mean, fine. I mean, nothing wrong with it, but just a microcosm of the album as a whole for me. It's fine, but it just doesn't excite me. What do you think?
I thought it was played very well.
Definitely
the whole feel and did a great job with it. And for this kind of song with this overall theme of, you know, when I'm thinking back to when I first fell in love with rock and roll, you know, appropriate note choices and all the little kind of classic rock and roll kind of stuff he's doing. No complaints. Tommy Thayer I say it every time, but he nails it. I mean, he knows what he's doing.
I don't think that's ever been in dispute.
Yeah.
If it has, you just simply don't know what you're talking about. But anyway, so what do we got? Post-solo? How much time is left in this?
44 seconds.
Oh, good. All I want, all I need. Why does he say dough? I don't care what you dough. He said it through the whole song.
I think it's what you're told.
Yeah, I think it is.
Is it told?
Yeah, I don't care what you're told.
Oh, I thought the lyric was, I don't care what you do, but he was saying, play it again. I missed told. It's weird. I don't know. It's strange. Music in the air, and I'm losing control. I don't care
what you heard. I don't care what you don't. Although I do hear doe now. Or yeah.
So now I'm hearing toe.
Toe.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it makes sense. Would rhyme with control.
Talking about it. I don't care if you towed my car.
Oh,
I'm losing it all to this rock and roll lifestyle.
Yep, fuck it.
Who knows?
Take the car. I don't care.
I don't care.
It's all about the music. Take the car. For the love of rock and roll.
You gave it an eye roll.
You know that, what was it? The Quiet Riot, "Mama, We're All Crazy Now" at the end. The hoo hoo.
Similar, huh?
Just reminded me of that. Yeah, just like throwing in a little fancy little whatever falsetto thing there at the end.
Yeah, not a fan of it over here, but you know. Whatevs.
So we made it through that one. You can cut the electricity.
Yeah, put that one in the rearview mirror.
Should we get straight to it?
Yeah, I think so.
Our first Eric Singer lead.
Is it really?
Yeah, right. He only has two in the catalog so far.
Yeah.
This was our first.
We didn't do the other one yet, right?
Nope.
All for the glory we haven't done yet?
No.
He's only sung lead on two songs.
As far as studio albums, yeah.
Yeah, all right.
But then he did like
Unplugged.
Yeah. Unplugged, and I'm sure he does Black Diamond. What
yeah.
have you.
Oh, yeah.
Did he do, I don't remember this, on that Sonic Boom disc?
I was just thinking that. I don't recall if that's on there or not.
What?
The bonus disc with it. I don't remember if Black Diamond was on it.
It is.
Is it?
And it's pretty an Eric Singer, yeah.
Is it?
I haven't listened to it in a while. I don't know. I thought it was more their, like, whatever you consider their hit hits, you know? Like, Forever is on there.
Yeah.
Chris loves that version of Forever.
I think it's actually
better than the original version.
Wow, we'll get to
Paul's
that.
Paul's vocal, a little more impassioned.
More on that later.
To my hearing, so.
Wowzers.
What's not to like?
Well.
Who wants to go first? Who wants to vote? Hell or hallelujah. Thumbs up, thumbs down, what have you.
I'll go first.
Chris.
I'm sending it to hell.
Oh.
Sorry.
Oh.
Whoa!
This just did nothing for me. I mean, it's least favorite song I've heard from Monster so far. And just in general, this album just doesn't float my boat. Make a Kiss Cruise pun.
What about that verse with the married woman? That excited you a little bit.
Yeah, but, you know, then I'm thinking back. It's like, you know, we already covered this in Hotter Than Hell and done better in that one. Yeah, it's not enough. It's just down to hell for me.
All right. Who's next?
I'll go next.
Nick.
I'm going to second that emotion.
Oof.
This is by
far someone who actually likes Monster.
By
right?
far my least favorite. Well, hold on. There's one more that I think Andy probably knows what it is. It's tied for my least favorite.
From this album?
On this album, yeah.
We haven't done it yet, then, right?
No, we haven't, and Andy knows it.
I'm not looking forward to that.
We discussed it, but yeah, I won't give it away. I mean, the performances are all there. You know, they're playing with as much passion and enthusiasm and, you know, just technical expertise as the rest of it's up to par in that regard
right.
with the rest of the album. But just the song, it seems like, I'm sure it wasn't the intention, but like Paul wrote this one and this is the one I'm not going to sing, you know,
right.
And it's Eric Singer's got a great strong voice, and it, you know, he showed it off on this one, but I think it could have been put to better use with stronger material. This as a song never did it for me.
Now, do you think that Paul Stanley wrote the song, who, you know, main dude,
Yeah.
You think he was like, man, you can have this one.
You almost
I'm
going to
take the good ones. You
almost get the feeling, yeah. But yeah, who knows? Who's to say?
Right.
He probably loves this song as much as the other ones.
That's true.
Probably just he felt this was the one that suited his Eric Singer's voice more. I don't know. But if you hear it and you really don't like it, you can almost kind of cook it up in your head that, like, hey, he gave him the scraps, you know. Who knows?
Yeah.
He gave him the Danny DeVito in the Twins universe.
Right.
All the garbage that was left over. Right. Not saying that this is garbage, but it's not one that I've ever enjoyed. So I pass it to Andy.
Okay. I give it a... That's a triple hell.
Wow. We haven't had one of those in a while.
You heard it here first.
The last one might have been Cadillac Dream. Or did somebody like Cadillac Dreams in this room?
I don't know.
I don't think so.
I can't imagine. I don't remember.
I don't either, but I doubt it. I don't know. There's too much rehashing going on in this song. I mean, it's even
too intentional, you mean? Like,
yeah,
it sounds
like some of the phrases, the Mr. Speed thing sounds like it's pretty intentional. And yeah. I think we talked about that kind of with Dangerous when we talked about that song, but it being in a positive way that it reminded us of classic Kiss songs. I don't know. Maybe it's just the difference between a song we like that reminds us of other songs we like and a song we don't like that's, you know, it's like, I'll stop trying to do the same thing. I don't know. And not doing it as well. I don't know what the problem is, but it's just kind of sat there for me, minus that one little verse that made my ears perk up just to hear what he was talking about. But other than that, the whole story of boy, you know, boy with the dream makes it happen, doesn't care about anything else.
Yeah.
It's always a nice theme, but I just don't want to hear it anymore.
Which
I don't
part
care.
Made you undo your tie?
Part about the toe.
Yeah. The toe. That's a
toe fetish coming into play.
Yep, that did it. All right.
Yeah, well. So we are not particularly enthusiastic about this one.
No, we are not.
No.
Well.
Never have been.
If you disagree, I'm sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Rubber stamped it.
Mm-hmm.
No take backs. Can't argue it.
I don't think anybody would have a take back. I mean, there have been some occasions where I've not been familiar with the song and I shoot from the hip and give it a one rating, and then I listen back or hear the song again and I might have gone the other way. It won't happen with this song.
No. This is done, huh?
In fact, I can pretty much guarantee that any time this comes up on shuffle, I'm clicking past it. I might even take it out of the shuffle rotation. Not interested in hearing it ever again.
That's
really.
That's not just like a hell vote. That's like a minus one.
Yeah, I can't envision a scenario where I would be into sitting down and listening to this all the way through. There's nothing there for me. So
it's kind of interesting how it worked out with the two Catmen. Similar themes in the song, kind of both. Sort of hearkening back to classic rock and roll sensibilities, and
have done much
better.
Last
week we all loved it, and this week we all are pretty indifferent to it.
That's because you could sense there's genuine energy and enthusiasm in Peter's version. It just didn't translate to this one.
Yeah, there's just something missing. I think
the main thing missing is he wasn't yelling at any old ladies.
That's true.
I mean, that definitely took things over the top.
Well, Eric Singer's not that kind of guy. He doesn't have that edge.
Yeah, if he did, he'd have knocked your ass out.
Exactly. Thank God he didn't.
He'd have just dropped you. He'd have given you the deluxe treatment.
So if Peter Criss is at this year's convention and Andy gives him the same routine...
Why would he do that?
No, I'm just saying, just hypothetically, if it was if it was Andy, you know, sauntering up in a zigzag pattern up to the table,
yeah,
after 40 beers, it probably would have gone a little differently,
right?
But
it would have taken me out.
Actually,
there.
That'd be great if Peter Criss was at it, but I don't see that happening.
He hasn't been at one, right?
Not the indie ones.
Ace hasn't either.
Ace and Peter seem to only do like the horror conventions.
Yeah,
they do those. Like I know they're in Chicago.
Maybe this quite is a bit too attached to the band.
It seems like it. Yeah,
Indianapolis.
It seems because they have they've had all the current members there,
right?
The last few years. So right. I don't know.
Well,
I don't see it happening, but it would be cool.
Yeah.
Well, they got to have some attraction. They got to.
Well, Pot of Thunder, and I don't know what else.
Well, that's not enough. Not nearly enough.
I don't think we're getting the invite this year.
No.
I'm going to predict it.
You think it's going to be reneged?
Yeah, I think that was just like a leave me alone.
They completely forgot about it by this point.
That's fine. I'm okay with that.
Which is fine. I don't want to be burdened with it. If they want us, we'll do it, but if not, we'll just go down there. But. They got to have some attraction to get people to show up, right?
Yeah. I would think so.
I mean, they got to have some member of KISS there.
Yeah, that's a requirement. To have somebody.
They'd be great if it was Peter Criss. I love that guy.
Well, this would be the year.
Maybe we should go to the next horror convention and go meet him.
Yeah.
I don't know.
If he does horror conventions, why wouldn't he do a KISS Expo?
I don't know.
I just feel like maybe it's too attached to the band. They don't invite him.
It's run by a guy who's a current employee of the band.
Yeah.
You know, maybe since they're... Yeah. I don't know. But speaking of the KISS fan nation, whatever, the podcast nation, I just real quick wanted to throw out a kind word for Mr. KISS Podcast himself and the whole community, Mr. Ken Mills. The very, very nice guy. I've talked to him on the phone a couple times. I guess he's
really
handling some sort of illness.
Yeah, he's
right?
not. He's. I don't know. It's some undisclosed, as far as I can tell. But yeah, I guess he's.
Poor dude.
Guess he's getting better. I hope he does. Really nice guy. I know. I'm sure just about every listener is going to know who he is.
Yeah, I mean, we've had enough of good people checking out. I mean, Abe Vigoda. I mean, come on. That's devastating.
He finally kicked it out.
I might be the worst of them all.
He's gone, huh?
It's like Bowie and Lemmy combined, the death of Abe Vigoda.
Right.
Well, Andy's going to go probably pop in Good Burger.
Well, there'll never be a Good Burger too now.
No, there cannot be.
Great. Just great.
Yeah, and Andy ain't the only one. The next time I watch that movie, I'll be misting up for sure. I'll tell you.
Good movie. It's his finest work.
I heard the guy who played Ed in that movie is going to be a pallbearer at Vigoda's funeral, as well he should be.
Carmen Electra will be one of the pallbearers.
Roxanne, play the character of Roxanne.
That's actually a pretty damn good movie.
That is good. Sinbad's in it.
Sinbad, of course, yeah. The whole the dance sequence in the mental hospital. Really good stuff.
That
reminds me of Disorderly.
That's what I was going to say.
That was pretty, I forgot
great
about
theme.
That part.
Yeah.
Good Burger.
It's not a bad movie.
Themed by Less Than
so
Jake.
So Ken Mills, if you're listening, throw on Good Burger and feel better.
Yeah. Mondo Burger. Wasn't that the competitor?
That was
I haven't seen this movie in years, but I saw it enough times to where I remember
you own it.
It's in heavy rotation on cable. I saw it as recently as last week. This was pre-Abe's death.
And, I have to refresh on this.
I imagine
that's good.
24-hour marathon right now.
It's like, what was just that Ed character. What a weird character. He's just constantly grunting. And it's like Andy when he's drunk making just weird noises out of anywhere. Just
upsetting
very strange.
All the animals in the area.
Very strange.
I like the line that
Andy's like the white Ed, basically, of Good Burger.
The only line I remember, and it's probably maybe one of the weirdest in the movie, is the Carmen Electra character. She's like, "Oh, what do you like about me, Ed?" He's like, "Your head." That's the line I remember. I'm like, "What is it?"
It's funny.
I'm telling you, it's a fucking good movie.
It is. Score by Stuart Copeland, right?
Is it really?
I think so.
Wow. It just
are you serious?
I'm pretty sure.
One of my all-time favorite drummers.
I'm pretty sure he scored the film.
That's a lot of quality people
you're not
involved.
Sinbad, Stuart Copeland.
Yeah.
Where does that collaboration happen?
He probably loved Good Burger. The sketch.
I remember I went to New York a few years ago and I saw a Good Burger there. I had to take a picture and send it to Andy.
Yeah.
As soon as I saw it, I'm like, I can't pass this up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Andy's had an affection for this movie for a while.
Oh, yeah. Since it came out.
Since, well,
did you see
I
it in the theater?
No.
No, but, well, DVD, right?
Yeah.
Pretty quick, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, I like the movie, yeah.
Yeah.
I'll have to go back and watch it and listen to the music.
Like, that's probably why Roxanne is in the movie.
the name
of the character, but when she appears, that's the song playing.
Is it?
Yeah.
I didn't know
there
that.
There you go.
See? I know my Good Burger.
Yeah, see,
I'm very deep with
Good
Burger.
I need to delve deeper into, you know, look for the sub-themes in the movie.
Yeah.
This, you know, the very complex goings-on of the storyline.
We're all dudes. That's really all there is.
Less than Jake and their shining moment in a commercial setting.
Just, you know, very deep layers of that movie. Hopefully it'll be on again.
Abe Vigoda in that movie where he fell and hurt himself and he had a funny line when he pointed it out?
I can't think of it either.
I fell or hurt something. Just the way he said it was great.
Yeah.
Fish is gone,
Terrible tragedy.
Bummer. That's the only... Yeah, no music related stuff. Just if Abe Vigoda,
so
94
I guess
years old.
The moral of the story is, you know, Ken Mills, if you're listening, you're not allowed to perish yet. They had way too many kings of society checking out. We can't handle anymore. Yeah. It's being relentless.
Yeah, so
lately.
Just knock it off, will you?
Yeah, take an extra antibiotic and get back on your feet.
There you go.
It's an order. We're not asking. We're telling.
All right. I think we go out on that.
That's the way.
Good call.
Kinds of sauce. I didn't go for the atomic. I was a little bit afraid.
What's that? Just the hottest one?
I guess it's like so hot that it's, you know.
It ain't that. I mean, it's hot.
You've had it?
Yeah, I've had it.
Okay.
Chris always goes for the hottest sauce.
Like the Blazin' at B-Dubs?
I'm actually backing off of that. Starting to experience some discomfort. It's not worth it anymore.
No.
But.
Let's get that on the show. Let's
recording
let's,
now.
Let's save. Oh, okay. Well,
what have
should
you?
We start it up?
My dreams of doing a heat challenge are probably over with.